Hey everybody, and welcome to a WWE RAW review for May 11th, 2015. So, obviously I wanted to get a TNA Impact review out there during the week and whatnot, but just never really had the opportunity to do so at this point in time. It's obviously unfortunate, but that's just kind of the way it is. So, I'm hoping to do an Impact review maybe tomorrow. Just talk about last week's Impact. Why not? I mean, it's been a few weeks since I've done one, so for those who've been looking for TNA reviews from me, you know, my apologies, but this is kind of the way it is. I've had a lot going on as of late, so there's no question about that. Anyway, let's just talk about Raw here. It is the go-home show to the Payback pay-per-view coming up this Sunday. And I just want to get some, you know, thoughts out there on this whole thing. And then I will have a pay-per-view predictions and review coming up over the weekend. So plenty to come in terms of talking about this whole thing this week. So thanks for tuning in, and hope you'll stick around and check this one out. We started the show off with Triple H talking along with Rollins and Kane in a promo. Basically, Triple H saying that things need to get back in order here. There's been a lot of chaos going on since he's been gone over these last few weeks. Rollins obviously agreeing with him and saying that, you know, him being on top is obviously what's best for business. Kane ends up getting involved, and, you know, him and Rollins go back and forth with Triple H separating the two of them and saying enough's enough. If Kane is not going to be on board and Kane is not going to ensure that Seth Rollins walks out of Payback with the title still, then yeah, Kane, you might actually be, you know, not right for this group. This might be the end for you. We might have to part ways here. So basically, you know, setting up, well, Kane, make sure that Seth Rollins remains WWE World Champ. So basically, by the end of this, Triple H ends up making some matches, puts J&J Security, who try to, you know, reason with Triple H, into a match against Dean Ambrose, the hometown guy from Cincinnati. And then you've got Reigns versus Kane, and then Rollins versus Orton. So matches we either don't really care for that much or are whatever. So either way, this opening segment, we set up the night, you know, established part of the main event, and, you know, did what it needed to do. It wasn't anything out of the ordinary, but pretty much just a regular old beginning to WWE Raw. So we get into our first match. Dean Ambrose faces J&J Security. Pretty much a joke here. Ambrose going over, no shocker there. At least J&J did get in a little offense. A little tiny bit. Whatever. At least it gets Ambrose over, and, you know, not only that, but Dean is very over with the crowd, and being at home was great for him. So, you know, it was a good way to cap off, I'd say, the build to Payback, and in my opinion was a nice opening match. So next up, we have Bad News Barrett defeating Dolph Ziggler in action with Sheamus at ringside, and Sheamus causing the distraction to help Barrett win. Ziggler got off to a hot start, looked like he was going to get the pinfall with Barrett still with his cape on, which made me laugh out loud to think about Bad News Barrett as King of the Ring being buried so quickly that he would actually lose a match so damn fast like that with his cape still on. But he ends up getting the victory, which is good for Barrett. Builds Ziggler versus Sheamus that much more, because Sheamus afterwards hits a brogue on Dolph. So definitely getting in some extra heat for Sheamus. That's a good thing. I look forward to their match. I don't think the build between Extreme Rules and Payback has necessarily been anywhere near as good as the build between two Extreme Rules has been for these two guys. But I think Extreme Rules was used as a platform to kind of continue that build on up through Payback. So that in of itself is a good thing. So I kind of like that. And I think that it works out fine in terms of that feud. Barrett, I guess, is going to face Neville. They didn't really do a whole lot with that tonight. But still, Neville was able to shine and have a nice night as well. Get into that in a bit. But either way, Sheamus and Ziggler gets a little extra build. So no real complaints from me. This wasn't anything like crazy good. But certainly wasn't anything to say, oh, that was terrible. Eric Rowan defeats Fandango, and then Luke Harper continues the beatdown on him. I mean, really, it's like, I'm glad that Luke Harper and Eric Rowan are back as a team, because neither guy had anything going for him on his own. Let's be honest here. Luke Harper is really good by himself. Like, he's a good worker in the ring, and I don't doubt that he can put on good singles matches with just about anyone, but the character doesn't really have much on its own, as far as I'm concerned. Eric Rowan really doesn't have much going for him. Put them together and they're a solid tag team. So, I mean, this is probably what's best for both of these guys at this point in time. So I really don't think it's a bad thing to have, you know, Harper and Eric Rowan back together as a tag team. I mean, I don't really think it's going to be something that, you know, is going to do a crazy amount of greatness for either guy, but I think that that's pretty much where they need to be right now, especially with the way that they, you know, didn't really succeed much on their own. I mean, Luke Harper has definitely succeeded in terms of putting on some good matches. I mean, he did hold the IC title for a little bit, but, you know, not really enough to me overall. They didn't really switch up, you know, and tell us enough about their backstories. All we knew was that they were getting released by Bray Wyatt. That's all we ever really found out. I'm glad they're back together as a team, but Fandango as your first victim? Yeah, that's a fucking yawn fest, so. Anyway, we get Cena and Neville for the US title next, and this was amazingly good. Now, obviously, Cena cuts the promo beforehand to build up the US title and whatnot. It's repetitive. We see the same old type of promo each and every week here to build up the United States Championship. And I'm not saying that that's a bad thing to have a promo before, but every single time it's almost like makes you roll your eyes after a while. It's like, man, this is enough's enough when it comes to, you know, Cena cutting pre-match promos before this U.S. title open challenge thing. But I do really like the open challenge concept. I think that having the United States Championship, you know, defended on a constant basis makes the belt feel more important. I think John Cena holding the belt makes the belt feel more important because of the fact that now, you know, he's defending it. Yeah, sure, he's retaining it, but it's also making the belt look good in the process. It's not about making Cena look good. It's also about making the belt look good. And whoever does beat John Cena for the United States title will then get a huge, you know, victory and a big moment for their career when they do that. So it'll be a good thing, whoever ends up beating him for the title. Neville had a great match with John Cena here. This was amazing stuff. And, I mean, there was some great near falls, had you emotionally invested. It was an incredibly good match, and there's no way to sell that short. I think having Rusev come in and attack and cause the DQ only added to the greatness of this segment. Now, some may say, oh, shit, a DQ finish, I never liked that. Now, yeah, sure, I don't like DQ finishes as much as the next guy, but this one actually worked, because not only does it helps everybody look good, is basically the overall assertion here. And Neville still looks great, because he put on a great match. It looked like he was seconds away from maybe defeating Cena. We don't know if that would have defeated Cena, because Rusev broke up the pinfall and caused the DQ. So now you have a situation where Cena not only looks good because, you know, he put on a great match, but Neville, the guy who really needs to look good, looks very strong here. It looks like he might have even won the match. And then Rusev also gets to look strong and beat the crap out of Cena. And not only that, but it also makes Rusev not look like a chicken shit because he wants to defeat John Cena. He doesn't want to defeat Neville or someone else for the US title. He wants to beat John Cena, the guy who took the belt from him. He wants to show that he can still, you know, he can actually get a win against him, and that, you know, this is who he really wants to face here. So he doesn't make him look like a chicken shit who just doesn't care who he faces. He just wants the belt back. No, he wants to prove that he is better than John Cena, America's golden boy. So it builds this whole thing up so freaking well, in my opinion. And I thought this entire segment was very well done. The match was awesome. The beatdown from Rusev was a good put in. And, I mean, yeah, sure, we know Cena's more than likely going to go over. It's quite predictable. But still, I think that they did a good job of at least cementing the build-up to this match. All right, so now we've got Tamina defeating Brie Bella in Divas action. I don't know if we're going to get a tag at the pay-per-view. I would assume Tamina and Naomi taking on the Bellas or something like that. I mean, I don't really care. It's not really a big deal, but Tamina and, you know, Naomi together, I think, is actually pretty cool. So I don't have any complaints with that. I'll tell you that much. So, oh man, then we got Mandow and Axelmania brother, the minor powers, I guess we're calling them. It sounds if there's any power with them, they're gonna take on the Ascension. Yeah, so it started off basically as them fighting each other, and then the Ascension come out and say, you guys, you know, you're not gonna get anywhere by trying to be someone else, right? Even though they're the fucking Legion of Doom, and that was the whole point of the segment. And so I guess the two teams are gonna face each other at the pay-per-view pre-show, the minor powers against the Legion of Bullshit. So there you go. what a pay-per-view match we've got in store for you. Four guys, all with potential talent and whatnot, all going to pretend to be somebody else. Amazing. It's like, wow. WWE's motto should be WWE Raw, the place where impersonation is definitely the sincerest form of flattery. And also the way to get over, I guess. Or what they believe will get you over. I thought this was dumb. It's not... it made me laugh, yeah, but it would be laugh because it's, like, dumb. And it's not even the kind of dumb that you're like, oh, but this could do some good for these guys. Like, they're impersonating other people. I liked Sandow's promo a couple weeks ago because of the fact that he was being realistic. And, like, yeah, sure, he was mocking Axel, but that didn't mean he had to go on and mock every... Like, I think this guy is too good to just be mocking a bunch of other gimmicks. Like, yeah, sure, it's funny. It'll make you laugh and whatnot. But, like, they made so much progress with this guy when he was Mizdow and show that he can really be a legit star. Like, yeah, sure, he was in the Miz's shadow, but, like, he emerged from it as his own being and as his own person. They kind of have... They've already dropped the ball on this, and I guess he's just going to remain at the job squad. But, hey, him and Axel will probably win against the Ascension because, you know, that's one of the worst burials you're ever going to see. Because those guys were amazing in NXT and then come up to the main roster and we've got a very different story. Which is a shame because, again, two really talented guys. So that's too bad. Okay, and then we get to the most somber piece of Raw and the most somber piece of news that we have. And it's the fact that Daniel Bryan had to vacate the Intercontinental Championship because of injury. He might be out weeks, months, or, you know, done for good. And this again reflects back to what happened about a year ago when he had to vacate the WWE World Heavyweight Championship. I mean, this is a shame. This is not only a shame because Daniel Bryan's a great talent, but it's just a shame to see a guy who loves what he does, is very dedicated to the craft, and, you know, to see him not be able to continue on potentially is just a real eye-opener. You know, it makes you realize that anybody at any time could lose their career, or that life is just short, and that careers are short, and you can't ever put a number on how long something's going to be in terms of a career or anything like that. So for him to have to vacate two different championships in two consecutive years is just awful. This guy works harder than probably any. He's worked so hard to get to where he's gotten. I mean, 10 years in the independent circuit, and then to come into, you know, WWE in 2010 and be just a great in-ring wrestler for the first couple of years and then get so over with the Yes gimmick and then become maybe the most over guy in the entire company, a top star that's a star with the mainstream, a star with everybody. He's worked his ass off to get his spot. But again, breaking down is a thing. It's a real thing for wrestlers. Not just small wrestlers, big wrestlers, any type, any size wrestler can happen to. The body breaks down. And he's already into his 30s. You know, you don't know how many more years he would have anyway. Some guys can go till they're 48. I mean, it just depends on the person. You know, and some guys are done at 33. It's just, again, it's hard to say. Again, if you've put your body through hell and done a lot of big high spots and, you know, worked very, very, you know, well in the ring and have a high work rate like a Daniel Bryan, you're going to put yourself through more. And yeah, you know, being smaller doesn't really help. You know, you don't, it's like, it's almost like being on the other end when you're real big. You know, it's the same type of thing. It's like your body goes through so much, it's hard to keep going, and you're going to have a lot of aches and pains once you hit your 30s. I mean, you know, the first 10 years of the career, you might shake off an injury that, you know, 5 years later is going to take you out for, you know, a year and a half. So it just goes to show you how tough professional wrestling really fucking is. And it's like anybody who's a pro wrestler knows that. Anybody who has any experience knows that. It's a very grueling business, and for people to sit there and call it fake, this is why those who are involved with the business get angry. That's why those who are hardcore fans get angry, because everyone realizes how difficult it is to get between those ropes and do it on a nightly basis. And then for you to sit there and call it fake is just so, you know, uninformed. It's so uneducated. It's such a stupid opinion to have, because you don't realize how tough it is. It's like, I want everybody who says that to step in between those ropes and actually take a bump and actually, you know, run the ropes and you know, simple stuff and realize, wow, this hurts. Wow, this is tough. Wow, this takes a lot out of you. Yeah, no kidding. That's what everybody's been saying to you the whole time, but you just think because it's entertainment and because that things are pre-written and scripted that, oh, well, it's fake. You know, it's like, no, it's an entertainment show. Yes, but what they're doing in the ring is still real, and you're still feeling the pain of a lot of things. And Daniel Bryan's been through a ton. So it's really a shame to see such a great guy have such a tough road. But let's just hope for the best for Daniel, whether it's, you know, he retires or continues on, whatever he decides to do. I hope it's the best decision for him, his family, and the future. The guy's a great competitor, and obviously, as a big fan of his, you want to see him come back. But more importantly than that, you want to see him be happy with himself, be happy with his life, and be in the best health possible. That's what you want to see more than anything else. So let's move on. Cesaro and Big E have a singles match. Cesaro getting over. And yeah, that's fine. Builds the tag team title match. Went on a little longer than I was expecting. But the New Day, just absolutely awesome right now. 2 out of 3 falls at the pay-per-view. I look forward to that match. I think it'll be quite good. And, yeah, I mean, Cesaro versus Big E, not the most unbelievable way to finish off the build, but it was a fine singles match, and Cesaro again showing his strength and ability, and it, some impressive stuff, and I liked it. So, I'm looking forward to the tag title match. I mean, I think it'll be good stuff. So, all right, so I guess the Elimination Chamber is coming back, by the way. That's nice to know. It's like 2 weeks from this Sunday, so I guess we'll see how that whole thing goes, but, I mean, it's a network exclusive, and that's nice. It's really a cool feature. It's kind of like how King of the Ring was, but it's just, like, such sudden build to it. I don't know. I guess it's, like, a way to hopefully get more people to check out WWE Network and a reason to stay subscribed to it, I guess, as well. And the NXT special on May 20th is probably the biggest reason, but, yeah. I will be doing a review for that, by the way, just to let you guys know. Like, I'm going to review that show just because there's, like, no way not to review that show, you know what I'm saying? But anyway, Elimination Chamber coming back. Always was a big fan of the match concept. Not sure what they're going to do with it. Maybe the vacant Intercontinental title Interchamber match? And that wouldn't be a bad idea. I mean, they're advertising it like it's a full-length pay-per-view. I'm not sure if it's like a 3-hour show, or are we looking at like a 1-hour special, similar to like King of the Ring? I mean, I don't really know. I guess we'll figure that one out. But anyway, we get Reigns. Oh yeah, I forgot to talk about Roman Reigns and Kane. I didn't really write this one down because the match never really took place. Kind of just Kane attacked Reigns. Reigns ended up spearing him. I guess they will have a rematch on SmackDown where there has to be a finish. So there has to be a winner. I guess if there's any reason to watch SmackDown, there you have it. So, primetime, I'm not saying that's a beautiful reason to watch, but there you have it. Primetime players with a impersonation of the New Age Outlaws. I mean, okay. Now, there may be a lot of impersonating going on in WWE right now, but at least the primetime players are making it really funny and entertaining, and they're still the primetime players at the end of the day. Like, they took everything and made it primetime players-esque, you know, and I think they're fun and entertaining duo anyway. I mean, I don't know, there's just like a different flavor to what they're doing, but I really want to start seeing these guys wrestle, and I'd love to see them be tag team champions or even feud with the New Day over the belts. No issues here with that. So, we move on to Wyatt and Ryback, a little bit of build to their feud that I don't give a damn about. Like, this is just a backward step for Bray Wyatt. Like, he goes from single-handedly building up his match with Undertaker and making it awesome to feuding with Ryback, and it's like, yeah, so what does this do for either guy? Like, and let's not forget, Ryback's had some really inconsistent booking. You go from putting him in a number one contenders match to having him squash Adam Rose like a week later. It's just, it's like these two guys are in like that booking hell right now, that mid-card, I don't even want to say mid-card, they're like, gah, hell. They're just in booking hell right now, I guess is the best way to put it. And it's a shame because Ryback is really over. He's a really good babyface, and I think he can be very valuable, and I think Bray Wyatt's equally good as a heel. great talker, can tell a good story, can put on a good program. There's no question about any of that for Bray Wyatt. Yet, when you put these two together, when they're both at a spot where it's like, where are we right now? Then it's not going to do anything for either guy. Like, again, I said a couple weeks ago, like, this could potentially do something for these guys. But it's not, because the way they're building it up is just, like, a huge step backwards to me. I think for both guys, especially for Wyatt, considering he just faced Taker at WrestleMania. But, you know, Ryback is definitely a really talented guy, but there's just no seeming direction for either one. So whoever wins the match, you're going to be like, all right, okay, and now what? Like, is this going to lead to an Intercontinental Championship or a U.S. title or, climb up the card, a more important feud, a Money in the Bank teaser? Like, what's going to happen here with this guy? So, like, is it going to benefit either guy? Like, neither guy is going to walk away from that match and look stronger and look better because of their victory. Like, these two guys are in the same position on the card. Like, they are both... I don't know where they are. Like, you know, there's no way to describe where exactly these guys stand. And I think both guys have a lot to bring to the table and both talented. You put them together when they're both in a better spot, you got a different story here. But when they're both kind of just, you know, floating all over the place, it's like, I don't really think that does a whole lot for either one. But we'll see. Either way, there was a little bit of a brawl. Ryback looking strong. I think Wyatt probably gets the win at the pay-per-view. That would be my guess, but I'll have full predictions this weekend. Thanks a lot if you do stick around and check that one out. Just want to plug the predictions coming out. I believe it should be Friday night. I don't know, one or the other. But yeah, anyway, so the main events. Randy Orton and Seth Rollins. Pretty damn good match. Ends in a DQ. That's no surprise at all. So Kane was at ringside but did not help Seth Rollins at all, who got surrounded by the other three guys who will be vying for his championship at Payback on Sunday. And then they all hit him with a finisher. And then they hit each other with finishers. Basically the same thing as last week. Reigns speared Orton. Ambrose ends up hitting the Dirty Deeds on Reigns. And Ambrose gets to look strong at the end of the night, just like he did last week. So, yeah. Dean Ambrose has had a very tumultuous ride to the top, if it's really even to the top. I mean, he's in a fatal four-way for the belt. Still in the main event, but, you know, it's a fatal four-way. It's not like he's getting a singles match with Rollins. So I think that's what kind of detracts me from saying, oh, well, they didn't build him up the right way. Yeah, they really didn't. I mean, the guy goes from, you know, like us being excited a couple weeks ago about the fact that he actually won a pay-per-view match to now just being in the main event. I mean, it's really kind of like a zip right to the top. But he's not really going to be there. You know, he's not going to win the belt at Payback. I'd be stunned. I'd say out of the four guys, he has the least chance of actually winning the championship here. But either way, this main event did what it needed to do. A solid matchup, puts all the guys in the ring, builds up to the world title. And I think this is a world title match I'm actually looking forward to, and I think the build has been pretty solid to it. I love the way that they inserted Ambrose into the match. I like that Kane has been playing against Rollins. I think that that's been fine. And not only that, but I like the fact that we got a fatal four-way. I think it's something different. You know, instead of just singles match after singles match, having a fatal four-way every now and then isn't bad. And yeah, sure, some fatal four-ways don't work out that well. Some fatal four-ways aren't that good at all. And sure, there's a lot of singles matches that aren't that good. There's triple threats that aren't that good. There's no way to know. I mean, three of the guys in this match are the Shield. The other one's Randy Orton. I would think that this fatal four-way is going to be a pretty damn good world championship match. This isn't just a fatal four-way with four guys thrown into it. This is a fatal four-way with three guys who were a stable and work very, very well together. And then Randy Orton, who has already proven that he can work quite well with Seth Rollins. Yeah, not as amazingly with Roman Reigns, but I'm sure him being in this match is still going to be fine. And some may view it as a spoiler to the Shield triple threat, as was discussed on PWF Empire Live earlier tonight with me and Jay. I will post the link to PWF Empire if you guys would like to check that out down below. But, you know, he was saying that he thinks it kind of detracts from it. And I totally see where he's coming from, but I personally think it just makes it that much more exciting for when it finally does happen, preferably at WrestleMania 32 as the main event next year. I think it's money next year for the main event. You could have Ambrose win the Royal Rumble. You could have Reigns, you know, win Money in the Bank this year. And you can have Rollins, you know, drop the belt, win it back, boom. All of a sudden, there's your triple threat or something like that. I don't even care what they do, but I want that triple threat match for WrestleMania 32, and who the hell wouldn't? I mean, the three Shield guys deserve to have a triple threat match because they're one of the best booked trios that, you know, we've seen, honestly. And a great trio of guys who were put so well together. So this match, to me, kind of teases that in a good way, and also is a nice match for everybody, and it's something different for the world title. And I think that they built so heavily up toward Rollins not retaining it, that he's going to end up retaining it. Either Kane is going to ultimately help him, or, you know, whatever. I think Rollins will, by nook or by crook, will walk away with the championship, and that's what will be good. And if he loses, he might not even get pinned, which will be good, because then he can freak out and then go nuts and get his rematch and whatnot. So it can all work out quite well. I'd say I'm really looking forward to this match, and I think they've done a solid job of building it up. So this Raw was not awesome. It wasn't bad, but it certainly wasn't awesome. I think last week's Raw was definitely better than this week's. That was like B+ territory, like I mentioned. This is like C territory. Like, I mean, you know, the Daniel Bryan segment was obviously sombersome, but it was also like a segment that I think, you know, was quite realistic and was well executed. The opening segment did what it needed to do and built up the night. You know, you got some Sheamus and Ziggler build in there. Neville with an amazing showing against John Cena and building up that U.S. title as well as you're going to build it up. You know, you get the main event segment, which does what it needs to do. So, I mean, you got some stuff that worked out for me. And then there were some things like the whole, you know, Mandel thing. And, oh, my God. And then, you know, Rowan and Fandango and things like that that you're just kind of yawning about. But it was like a C Raw, you know. It covered the biggest bases it needed to and did at least provide some final build to some of the feuds. So that much, I gotta say, is good. I think it was like a straight C. And I think that's fair. I really do. It's not, you know, too great, not too bad. Just right in the middle. C. So definitely have seen worse Raws. I don't think it was a terrible show by any stretch. But I definitely don't think it was a great Raw either. But either way, I think Payback has been built up decently well. You know, again, the whole Wyatt and Ryback thing has been pretty piss poor. But other than that, most of the stuff hasn't been that bad. The main event primarily has been good. And they've built up the U.S. title enough. I mean, yeah, you know who's going to win. I'm just hoping for a solid pay-per-view. That's basically what you want out of Payback, is a solid outing. It's kind of like, you know, any other pay-per-view that's like that. You know, you're just hoping for something solid. You know, if you expect 10 out of 10, then, you know, you're not watching the right thing here. It's like, you can't sit there and be like, yep, that show better be a 10 out of 10. It's Payback. Come on, it's not WrestleMania here. And the build-up has been solid. And so why not get a solid show out of it? That's what you hope for. And we'll see what happens on Sunday. So, all right, the plan for the week, again, tentative, because that's kind of just the way it is with me, and I apologize for being that way, but again, a lot of stuff going on in life. It's not always easy to get videos out there, but after this Raw review, I'm hoping to do Impact sometime tomorrow, and then later in the week, the Q&A, finally. I, like, started to film it, and then, you know, ran out of space, and there was all this bullshit going on with it, so I'm just going to refilm it. Hopefully Wednesday or Thursday, that'll be up. And then, again, pay-per-view predictions, review coming up this weekend for Payback. So plenty to come from me, hoping to get it all out there sooner rather than later. Be sure to check out PWF Empire Live, NEBW New England Backyard Wrestling. Links in the description for both. Please do check them out. Follow me on Twitter at EMUltraOfficial. Other than that, that's going to do it for this one. So until next time, guys, have yourselves a great night, and peace out.